name's Rob. I organize Idea to IPO. We've been doing events in Silicon Valley for a number of years. We hold events from San Jose to San Francisco multiple times a week. We have a very busy calendar. I'd like to highlight a few events that are coming up. July the 7th, in this room, featuring Rich Foreman, CEO of Aptology, building an app from idea to execution. July the 12th, Steve Blank, in conjunction with Commonwealth Club, hacking for better defense. And one of our showcase events, pitch to investor panel, July the 14th at the College of San Mateo. So in fact, we're looking for startups that want to pitch to an investor panel. Who is raising money and would like to pitch to investors? Okay. Who has a market-ready product, users, sales, and revenue? Good. So come talk to me later, and we'll talk about what's involved. We were launched officially February 1st, 2012, or 2010, actually, February 1st, 2010. We had no members, no events on our calendar. At this stage, we have over 40,000 members with all our meetup groups in the Bay Area. We've completed over 1,569 events. We're the most active startup event organization in Silicon Valley, bar none. You guys are fast learners. I appreciate that. Our mission is to promote entrepreneurship, support entrepreneurs, build community, and provide value in the Silicon Valley startup ecosystem. So to that end, we provide content that's practical, actionable, and relevant, stuff you can actually use to succeed as entrepreneurs. We believe in community because Silicon Valley is an aspirational ecosystem, and it attracts people from all over the world who come here to become great entrepreneurs and great innovators. But if you come here from somewhere else, you don't know anybody, that's a problem. So we provide channels for you to meet people, build relationships, grow your network. In fact, we have a regular TGIF mixer. CJ Terrell is one of our team members who runs that event. Let's hear it for CJ.
Hi, everyone. I'm CJ. Thanks for coming out tonight. So we have these regular TGIF mixers that are great ways to kind of meet who's coming into Silicon Valley newly, or those who live here, those in the corporate scene, those as investors, or those who have startups. They tend to all come together, and we make it a very fun experience. We meet at the Hyatt Regency in Santa Clara. We have them every couple weeks. Our next one's going to be on July 15th, and they're from 8 to 11 p.m. They're free events. Highly recommend coming. Get a lot of exciting people out there and get to hear a lot of neat stories. Hope to see you there. Thanks.
CJ also poses as a Justin Bieber lookalike on weekends. Yeah. With regard to value, it's important that we provide value at each and every one of our events, not just value for your money, which is important because a lot of entrepreneurs are struggling, so we make sure our events are priced so that they're affordable, and we try and provide a decent meal at our events. Is that a decent meal back there? Okay. Well, I hope so, because I prepared most of it myself from scratch. Yeah. But more importantly, we want to provide value for your time, which is your most valuable resource. Anyone in here getting any younger? Besides you in the front? Just kidding. Time is your most valuable resource, so when you commit time and invest time to be at our events, we want to make sure that you maximize your ROI. So we have a lot of partners that help us do what we do, law firms, venture capital firms, angel investor groups, incubators, accelerators, colleges and universities, and lots of players in the Silicon Valley startup ecosystem. Tonight, we're grateful to InnoWest for hosting us at this beautiful venue. And if you're interested in finding a place to set up your company, InnoWest is a great place, so come talk to me later about all the details. Some of our other partners are here tonight. I'd like to have them come up and say a few words. Let's hear it for Long from Aptology.
This mic is to record. Good evening. Thank you, Rob. My name is Long. Good to see a lot of familiar faces. Again, my name is Long. I'm with Aptology. We are a local California-based full-service mobile app development company. We are a 50-person company. We've been in business a little bit over 5 years. Done about over 500 apps, customers ranging from small restaurants to Fortune 500 companies. I myself have been in sales and marketing for companies like Cisco, WebEx, Citrix, a lot of small ones that you may not have heard of for about 20 years. So I'm not a self-proclaimed sales guy. I've actually carried quotas and all that fun stuff. So why us? So anyone can build your app, but our differentiator include helping you marketing and selling that app. We can share with you some of the challenges are from customers like yourself. What is working for them? What isn't working? What can you do with $500? What can you do with $10,000? And basically, I have a network of people like yourself that I can connect you with so that you can learn from them. Because I myself don't have all the answers, of course. We can also be a bridge IT gap. What that means is we can manage and monitor your app, basically service your IT house until you have enough traction and enough have revenue to grow out your IT team. Because that's one of the, actually the killer of ideas. You spend so much money that you haven't made any money, and before you see any success, you're broke and have to go get another job. So the other thing is I also help my partners look for partners or co-founders. We're doing some very interesting apps. One is in the moving space. One is in the sports space. One is in the health ID space. And the other one is a party app. So if any of those subjects is of interest to you or of interest to you, please let me know. Because, again, they're looking for partners. And lastly, we also selectively invest in apps. That's really how I make my living. There's very little money in mobile app development, as you guys probably priced around. So anyway, coffee's on me. I love to hear about your ideas, share with you what little knowledge I know in the last 20 years, and if we can help each other, let's do it. Thank you. I will pass my cards around.
I think Long was asking if anyone was interested in partying. Didn't you ask that?
Yeah.
We have one person interested, at least. Okay. Another one of our partners tonight is Chrissy from Trivantis. Let's hear it for Chrissy.
Hello. My name is Chrissy. I'm with Trivantis IT Security Consulting Company. We offer technical testing on applications, so that could be anything from a pen test, penetration test, vulnerability scan. We can also do IT governance type, a whole list of laundry items, including source code analysis. We do gap analysis and incident response planning. We also do red team exercises, so if your team needs security awareness training, we do that. Anywhere from malware or phishing attacks, we can talk to you about more on if you're using Amazon Cloud or Microsoft, we can help you on those stacks. My name's Chrissy Trivantis. I'll have my business cards out here if you want to talk more. Thank you.
All right. Next up, we have Kay from NetServe. Let's hear it for Kay and NetServe.
Hi, guys. I will be quick. I'm Kay from NetServe Consulting. So we help startups and companies to support and implement network infrastructure and cloud strategy. If you are interested, come and see me. Thank you.
All right. Next up, we have Mike from CTO 911. Let's hear it for Mike.
Hi, everyone. My name is Mike with CTO 911. I'm a CTO consultant here in Silicon Valley, specializing in enterprise software development. I help entrepreneurs and startups with their prototyping, design, and architecture, database systems. Review. I basically partner with the entrepreneur to become their quote unquote CTO that works with them to solve their technical problem. A lot of entrepreneurs, you know, are experts in the fields that they're in, but not necessarily in software development. So I partner with them to basically come up with the right solution and approach. Or if you're stuck somewhere along the process, you need some additional somebody to talk to, shoot some ideas, figure out what to do, roadmaps, directions, timeline. As well as recruiting, setting up teams, I can help you do that as well. Again, my name is Mike. I'll be hanging around, so it'd be great to talk to you afterwards. Thank you.
So Without further ado, I'm going to introduce our featured speakers. They are funny, I think, dynamic. They have decent hair. Let's hear it for John Rampton and Murray Newlands.
Thank you. No, I'm just joking, you guys. How's everybody doing?
Good.
You guys doing good? See some energy. Come on. How's everybody doing?
Great.
Yeah. That's what we want to hear. Well, Murray's going to get us started.
So thanks, John. So apparently, because we're recording this, I have to stand behind the microphone. So I'm going to be the static one, and John's going to be the dancing leader. Thank you all for coming tonight. So to give some introduction, we both write for a number of different publications. I write for Forbes and contribute to Entrepreneur Magazine. John contributes to TechCrunch, Mashable, Forbes, Inc., Huffington Post, a range of different publications. We both get pitched by startups a lot, and so we want to share some of that information with you tonight and help your startups get ahead. So to give you a bit more background about me, I started in online marketing 19 years ago. I have worked with different lots of different companies, from large companies to small companies. I was working between the UK and US. I found that you could get a visa to move to America as an alien of extraordinary ability. As a famous writer, I set up a blog about marketing in the UK, and it took off. It became really successful. My topic was marketing because that's what I knew. I got to speak internationally. I got a book deal with Wiley, which is a publishing company. I was interviewed in many different publications around the world, and that's what got me my green card to actually move to America. And as I was doing that, CEOs of companies who I knew said, hey, can you help me communicate with my company? Can you help me find a voice? Can you help me contribute to publications? And so that also led to a business and many different opportunities. As well as writing for different publications, I have grown my Twitter following. I have 1 million Twitter followers. I have different reach through different mediums. I do a lot of video work. I'm an advisor to 2 investment funds, and I work with them. Once again, I'm constantly being pitched. So although we're talking about how to get press for your company, we'll also talk about that within an investment environment, because I know that's of interest to you guys as well. I also work with John and a number of different companies and startups.
Hey guys, I'm John. I am a startup guy. Tonight I'm going to be sharing a little bit about some of my experiences, some of the companies that I've worked with, some of the people that I've made to be ballers online. Murray and I work with lots of people. We have an agency. We run different startups. I have a payments company. We have a payments company. We just sold a hosting company to one of your largest hosting providers in the world. But tonight we're going to be sharing a lot of how we took these companies from small companies and startups with just the two of us to very, very large companies that have multi-millions in revenue, as well as how we worked with some people just like yourselves and made them very, very influential online and kind of replicating what we're doing. So it's going to be a little bit about what we talk about tonight. My name is John. I write for Everywhere. I write for TechCrunch, Mashable, Inc., Entrepreneur, Forbes, Huffington Post, CNN, and lots of different places. I do this because it's the best way for me to get my voice out there, to help people out, and to get my startups out there and drive back millions of users to myself. So I'm going to be teaching you, or we're going to be teaching you, a lot about this tonight.
So you're all here to find out how to get press for your company. The first question you need to ask yourself is, why are you doing this? Why are you trying to get press for your company? What are the different business objectives behind getting press? What are you trying to shine a light on? And what you're trying to do business objective-wise will set a lot of the agenda as to how you do it and where you communicate. So for example, how many of you are trying to raise again? There are about 10 of you are trying to raise.
Raise your hands high. Who's trying to raise money?
And how many of you are trying to get customers?
Is that all of you?
Is anyone not trying to get customers?
Why? Okay, one person's not trying to. What are you trying to do?
I have customers and don't have the product.
Okay.
Okay. A good problem to have, typically. Cart before the horse.
So that actually raises a point, and that's when you should start. So here's the thing. When you're trying to pitch eventually, or trying to pitch journalists or other people in the space, a lot of it is about who you know. A lot of startups start in the process that we're in stealth. Don't tell anyone about it. My advice is that you want to network as much as possible from as early as possible. And you want to share your story. Even if someone else hears about your idea, can they execute it in the same way as you do? Can they execute it better than you? If you're a great CEO, if you're a great founder, you should know that you're the best person at delivering this product. So why do people try and get press for their startup? Well, one of the reasons is to impress investors. Another reason is to try and get customers. But here's the thing. If you're trying to impress startup investors, you might be trying to hit, for example, the bigger press. You might be trying to hit broader press. That will give you nice brand names for your presentation. It will give you nice exposure to a much broader audience. But they're probably not the people who are going to actually be customers for your product. If you're trying to reach customers for your product, you're probably trying to reach much more niche press of people looking for this, more like trade press, more like industry press. And so you're trying to reach a different type of audience in a different sector with a different type of message.
John. So I want to ask you guys this. Why are you guys here? Why are you here?
We need PR for our startup.
Why?
Because we're trying to impress investors.
Okay.
And get customers.
Okay.
But we're spending all our time in promoting at niche conventions and industry.
Okay. So get press for investors primarily, and then secondary customers, correct? Okay.
So that's why the investor comes first.
Okay.
But it's better to get the customers first because the investors will follow.
Okay. Why else?
Yeah, I was going to say the customers first.
Yeah. Anybody else? Why do you guys want press?
Could you repeat the question?
Yeah. Why did you want press? Oh, then she said customers. So why else?
Are you looking for the answer of validated idea?
No, I'm asking you guys in general so I can craft my answers a little better for you. So what were you saying?
A lot of people do that. They promote a product before they even really get to square one just to test it in the marketplace, see if they
respond. Lots of people do test a product, just to make sure they're getting validation. Anyone else have different reasons of getting press? Ernie?
Your pitch sucks.
Your pitch sucks. Okay. And you want to get your ideas better. So you guys, press is not created it's not equal. So some people are like, I want press for investors, which is great. And it's more on knowing what you guys want. And I think from the beginning when you're going after press, you guys really need to understand what you want. Because if you want press for investors, that's very, very different than customers. And you're going after very, very different people. For example, has anybody ever been on Forbes before? Did it drive customers? No, doesn't drive any customers. Hardly anybody's going to see it. They're not going to get a whole lot of attention. But investors love it. And customers love seeing a validation from Forbes. Oh, you guys were mentioned on Forbes? Oh, cool, I'm going to buy it. It's cool on your website, but it's not going to drive a whole lot of views. So you really need to understand the why and why you're doing this. So that will help you better pitch yourself to people who are going to write about your company. So really, you know, questions that I ask myself and clients and stuff like that is, again, why are you doing this? But dig a little deeper into it. Like, really get into, like, oh, I want customers. What type of customers do you want? Because that's going to, as well, dictate where you go. For example, if I want business customers, would I rather go to Inc., or would I rather go to a small little publication that writes for exactly who I want to go to? So I had a person come to me today, and they were like, oh my word, like I have the best results ever from this little tiny magazine that really only 2,000 people read every single month. That is the readership of this one blog, 2,000 people. And they're like, anytime we get covered in this blog, it'll drive us 20 qualified leads. And these are all of seasoned CMOs of Fortune 500 companies. And they all read this stupid little blog. It's actually a really good blog. There's very, very good information. But apparently, all CEOs read this little blog. And I was really, really surprised by that. And then he's all, yeah, we used to get on Inc. and do all these things and think that's where we're hanging out. But then we started paying attention to the traffic on our website and where people were coming from. And 50 times more people came from this little place. So you need to know a little bit of your why and who. Who you guys are targeting. Because the more you understand exactly the person and what you guys want out of press, the better you guys can pitch it.
So that comes down to the basics of trying to get press. You need to work out, obviously you've worked out with your startup, and you need to focus on what problem am I trying to solve? And how is that relevant to different audiences? So if, for example, as in that scenario, you've got a marketing product, you're trying to pitch it to marketing CMOs, find the place where marketing CMOs read the most. For example, the lady at the front was saying that they go to lots of niche events. Niche events are great because you'll find lots of bloggers who go to that event who are niche press for your industry. They're often very approachable because it's a small event, because it's a niche event. It's easy to make a personal connection with them. And if they're interested in that topic, that industry, that area, and they're at that event, they're likely to be writing about that event. And their audience is interested in that type of topic. And the audience has the types of problem that are being fixed at that type of event. One of the best ways to get press is to know press personally, individually. If you go to smaller niche events, you're less likely to meet lots of press. But you're going to find the press that are absolutely interested in that topic. So when you're looking at press, think about who their audience is and why they write. That's the crucial thing. A lot of people think of press as this alternative being, as in they look at investors as an alternative being. You need to think of them as humans. And they're trying to write content for humans. They don't want to write about the release of a new product or release of a new software update. No one cares about a new software update. What people care about is the fact that they have a problem and they want to find information to solve that problem. Writers, journalists are writing for their audience. They know their audience has problems and they're trying to solve their problems. So what you want to be able to do is understand who are the journalists covering the problems that your topic, your software, your solution is fixing, and pitch to them why they should write about your startup and why it's of a concern to their audience. Think about this. As a writer, I'm tasked by my editor to write great content that, in the broader sense of the word, entertains or educates my audience. And what you need to do is you need to position yourself as a solution for me to be educating, entertaining my audience.
Yeah, let me jump in there really quick just to make sure you guys get that. I get pitched every single day on average by 200 to 250 people. 200 to 250 people. And I might write about one of them. So if you're pitching me your product, oh my word, I just launched this product. I do not care. Oh, my feature, I released this cool new feature. They don't care. Like, I know we read on TechCrunch or sometimes, and Adobe released this new feature. And they're paying people a lot of money to pitch that out and to the point where they annoy the people or they have the relationships to get that out. But most of the time in the startup world, you're not going to be able to get your brand new product or this covered by news. You have to solve problems and pitch the problem and that you guys have a solution.
Yeah, so it's a lot of startups say, well, Google released this thing and they got lots of press coverage. Well, the fact that Google released a product means it's going to affect millions of people's lives instantly. Okay. The fact that you release something doesn't mean it's going to affect millions of people's lives instantly. That's the difference. So, okay, so how do you get PR? I recommend, as I say, starting off with those niche groups. Go to those niche group events. Meet those local bloggers that write about local topics. The other thing that you'll find is that lots of those writers, lots of those bloggers write for lots of different publications. Just as John writes for lots of different publications, lots of those smaller publishers will also write for lots of publications. Now, here's the thing. He writes for different publications, and each different column he writes is for a different topic. So within that, you don't want to pitch him broadly. You want to say, I see you write a column at this publication. You write about these different topics. I see your audience is really interested in these topics, and here's the problem that that audience has, and here's how my company might fit within a story to fix that problem. So it's all about how you're communicating your message to that niche story.
Okay, I'm gonna tell, I'm a little bit of a storyteller. Marie's more of the needy-greedy, so I'm gonna tell you guys a story about some of the things that I have worked on the past. And to get in, you need to know your story, you need to know how to do that. But let me explain how to find people and how to find press. Do you guys know how to find press? Anybody here? No? Do you guys want some help? Okay, I'm gonna tell you about a little startup that I used to work on. It's called Pixlu. Terrible name, I know. It was a good product. It took me 9 months to build. I used to work at a company and they weren't serving a particular need, so I left that company and I went and built a product around that subset of people, and I built it, and we launched it successfully. In a month and a half, we'd acquired almost 90,000 users, and it got acquired by a very, very large company for a very large sum of money. It was great. It's like a perfect Silicon Valley-like success story, right? But what people don't realize is how much effort I put into the launch, a one day. How much time and effort I put into one single day, and that was my launch. So we built the company, and it took 9 months to build. I had one developer and myself, the marketing guy. 9 months. So you guys are like, well, what were you doing during the 9 months, marketing guy? I was figuring out how to launch that product the entire 9 months. I was prepping for one day, for 9 months. Now you guys might be like, oh my word, that's so much time, so much effort. But really, there's a lot that goes into finding these people. First, you guys need to become the best stalkers on the planet. Is anybody here a legitimate stalker? Kim, your hand just shot up. Front row, she's like me. You guys, Marie's heard this a couple times. Maybe some of you guys have heard my story on how I met my wife. Has anybody heard how I met my wife before? You have. So I met my wife. This is how good of a stalker I am. And sorry for you who have heard it. I'm a really good stalker, like creepy stalker. Like I'm the guy in the computer. So I met my wife and I saw her at a party and I thought she was really, really hot. Right? And I'm like, oh, wow, she's hot. So what did I do? I walk up and I go and I walk past her, you know, get a good look. And then I go home, find her online. Because of course I'm not gonna go talk with her. I'm a human being, right? Do we talk with people anymore? No, we don't really talk with anybody. So I go home and I add her on Facebook. And this was years back, and I add her, and she like adds me back, obviously, because I'm so good looking. And you know, a couple days later, she's chatting me online, and she's like, "How do I know you?" And I'm like, "Oh, we know each other. we know each other really well. And she's all, no, we don't. No, we don't. I'm all, we know each other super well. Like, yeah, I met you at this party and at this. And she's all, not really. Like, if you know me so well, tell me something about myself that nobody else knows. And I was like, you don't tell this to a, yeah, exactly, a challenge. You don't tell this to somebody like me, Uber stalker, right? So I then proceed to go and do my little hacking abilities and do this. So I then proceed to give her her three previous home addresses. And if you know me, it's like, I'm sitting there with my bros, like, you know, having fun, and we're like, eh, I just totally freaked her out. Of course she doesn't talk with me for a couple days. You know, immediately ends the conversation, doesn't even respond. And I'm like, ha, ha, ha. But being the persistent one, I got a friend, and it all worked out, and we ended up going on a date and falling in love and, you know, a couple of drama things in between. Now we're married. We have a baby daughter. Everything's wonderful, and I am extremely happy. But you guys, this is just like going off on how good of a stalker I have become. And during this 9 months, I learned how to stalk like nothing else on these people. I learned how to stalk like everything. So I went and looked up every single one of my competitors. I went and looked back over the past 2 years, every person who'd written about who competed in the same place. I got to know every single detail about every single one of those people. I would read, on average, 2 to 3 hours every single day, a blog post written by, it was about 120 different authors every single day. And they wouldn't write all day, and I began speed reading and, you know, checking this and that. But I began to know every single one of these authors who'd written about my competitors and would write about my startup potentially. Then I got to really stalk them. I started stalking them and finding out what conferences they were going to, what conferences they were speaking at, where they lived, where they participated in, what events they were going to. And I casually showed up and met them. Well, after, the thing is when you meet somebody one time, they will not remember you. If it's just a casual person and you meet a press person, they will not remember you the second time. Or they'll be like, no. The second time you meet them, they'll be like, oh, I think I've met you. If it's one-on-one and you go up and say hi, oh, hey, I've read some of your stuff. I've been a fan. I do that. Then I come back the second time. Oh, hey, it's me again. I saw you at this other event. You know, I read this story last week that you did. It was awesome. Getting a little stalkerish, but you don't want to show your stalkerish, right? You don't want to come up and be like, I knew your three previous home addresses. That's really creepy, and I shouldn't have done that, but it all worked out, surprisingly. No idea why. But on the third time of meeting these this person, they knew I was part of their tribe, and almost every single one of them remembered me. And I went up to them, hi, oh, you remember me? Oh, I've seen you a couple times. Great seeing you. Great. After that, that right there is a very warm lead, because now I'm part of their tribe. They're part of my tribe, and I'm friends with that person. And this is one of the best ways that I personally have found to get press, is to be part of their tribe, know what they talk about, what they do. I comment on their stuff, not every single one. I'm not creepy. I mention things. I make relevant this, relevant that, and I really get to know them. So during this 9 months of prepping for this company, I was on average at 3 conferences a week. Stalking these people, meeting them, networking. But really, it was stalking them. I got to know every single one of these 120 people. That made me, literally, I had to fly all across the U.S. and Canada and even internationally to meet some of these people. That's how important it was for me to have a one-on-one relationship with every single one of these people. Well, when we launched, I went to almost every single one of them, and I said, hey, you know, I met you at this conference, and we hung out, did this, and oh, I went to drinks and did this, and oh, I'm friends with this, and great post. I did everything I could to get in the doors. Guess how many of those people wrote about me? All but 12 of them. I had 108 people write about my startup in one day. What do you think that did? Viral. everybody started writing about it. We had, I mean, it was like 60 or 70,000 customers in one day sign up. Everybody thought we were this one-hit success. We were two people. But I prepared for this day for 9 months.
So some takeaways from that, because you can get lost in John's stories easily. If you don't have someone working on this in your team, work out how are you going to get that resource there. It's not something that you're going to do in one day. Lots of startups build everything out. They spend an afternoon writing a press release. They get a press list from a friend, and then they mail it out. Spam is an email from someone that you don't know with content that you don't care about. Far too many startups are sending spam because they haven't bothered to build a relationship. If you want to get great press, you're going to have to put the work in. Either it's going to be you as a co-founder, you're going to hire someone on the team to do that, or you're going to hire someone else to do that. It's if you wanted to have if you want to have a great app with a great idea, you want to have it built and you want to have lots of press about it. If you want to get lots of press about it, you have to have the resource. If you want to have it developed, you have to hire a developer, or you have to be able to do it yourself. So you need to put that work in. Press is a lot like making sales, like business development. You have to build those personal relationships over time. You have to know exactly who your target is. You have to know exactly what they want. When you meet them, be ready to meet them. Think about how you're going to pitch them, what you're going to pitch them, what's going to be interesting to them, what they really care about. So you found out tonight that John has a daughter. That's something that he cares about. He just has a baby girl. Anyone that's had a child knows that that's, at that time, that's what they're super interested in at the moment. He writes about tech, but now you also know something personal about him that he really cares about. So you need to know who those people are and how that's going to work. So also, when you get that opportunity, be ready to pitch them. Know exactly, okay, I know who this is. I know what they write about. Now, when you meet a new contact for the first time, what do you do? Do you ask them to please buy my product? Never do that. Ideally, when you meet people, you're not meeting them at the moment that you need them. You're not meeting them at the moment you're trying to pitch them. So build a relationship with them. Find out what they're writing about. Find out what they want to write about. Find out the kind of people they meet. Can you be a resource for them? If they're working on different stories, maybe you can help introduce them to other people who could provide sources for those stories. That's great. Why is that great? Number one, if you can provide great resources for them, it's a reason for you to exchange emails with them. Phenomenal. You've got their email. You've also got their attention. And you're able to help them. As and when you've built that relationship in the future and you want to pitch them something, it's a lot easier to pitch something to someone when you've already helped them in the past, when you've got a relationship with them, when you know the types of thing that they write about. So build that backstory and work out how you're going to develop that as you're going along. So make sure it's a personal relationship as well. It's not just info at or press at my company. No, it should be your personal contact details. Don't be explicitly salesy about it. Make sure it's building that personal relationship. They know who you are, you know how they work, you know how they're helping you. So here's something else. Give back to your community and be an authority within your community. So for example, if you take tonight, if you wanted to know the most connected people, if you want to truly connect with people throughout Silicon Valley, if you want to know who the investors are who are right for different types of project, who's the one person in this room who might know that? Rob. Rob knows more people in Silicon Valley than anyone else because he organizes events. How can you be part of your community? How can you help to organize events? I've done lots of projects for startups where I've organized get-togethers, meetups, events for bloggers and press in their space. They wanted to get together. I put together great content for them, and it was a means to get them all together, and we helped facilitate that for them. And so those companies, those startups, were able to network with all of those people. So work on developing all of that. Also, getting your pitch right is super important. John finds startups to write about anywhere, and there have been several occasions where John's on the lift, he's like, right, he just says to startup, right, give me your 30-second elevator pitch, because literally we're in an elevator going up. Normally he's hugged them first, and that normally freaks them out a bit, but he just says, give me your elevator pitch.
It's true.
If they've got a great elevator pitch, he actually sometimes writes about them. And lots of them say, no, A, I'm not interested in pitching a random person in the elevator, and B, I'm not ready for it. Well, that's a disaster. Like, they had the opportunity, they weren't ready, they didn't have the moment. Equally, lots of the times I've been chatting with other members of the press, and so they start getting in a conversation with a startup, and it's obvious the startup doesn't know how to pitch what they do. They just talk about the product. The worst thing is they just talk about the product and the product feature. It doesn't relate to anything else. You've got to make your startup relate to humans. One way or another, you're helping people with problems. Think about how to make it an exciting, newsworthy story. So what is news? Either it's something that's relevant with something else that's happening at the moment, or it's something that really is on the cusp that's catching people's attention. How is your startup relevant to the news? John, you did a great case study with a sports team where you created an infographic around the ball game.
Oh, yeah. So I've done lots of... I created one that got featured on TechCrunch and Mashable, where I compared the success of a startup is a lot like marketing specifically is a lot like baseball. Anybody play baseball? Yeah, watch it. Anybody? Other sports? Okay, fine. But baseball, you guys know what it is, right? Hitting ball with a bat, not cricket. But when a person gets up to bat, right? What are the chances of them getting to first base? Do you guys know? Yeah, it's one in every two, one in every three. What's the chances of hitting a double? It's like one in every, I think, 8 to 12, right? What's the chances of hitting a triple? Triple is actually one in every 48. A home run is one in every 32. One in every 32 people get up to bat. It's a home run, statistically. It might be 64. I don't remember the exact. But then a grand slam is one in every 1,064. But I related that very similar to marketing. Marketing and social media is very, very similar. How many times do you get up to bat? The more you get up to bat, the luckier you get. That was one that got picked up by other media organizations. But one thing I think Murray touched on a little bit is news-related items. And things that I really like is news, because every person, like with everything that's going on in Europe right now, it's a great time to take advantage of that and create news stories around that. For example, the last time, do you guys remember, I believe it was Brussels who went bankrupt? Or no, Greece. Greece that went bankrupt, right? Sorry, not Brussels. Yeah. You guys know what I meant. Whatever. Yeah, I'm going to walk off right now. So Greece went bankrupt, right? So I have an invoicing company and a payments company. So we went and pulled all the data from Greece. And we said, oh my word, on average, every person in Greece using our system is on average making like $2,500 a month. But when that happened, the data went from $2,500 to $20. Nobody was invoicing at all. So I hit up CNN with that. I'm all, hey, this is actually pretty good news. Like, although we only have like 1,500, 2,000 customers there, from the average invoice and the average person making a couple thousand dollars to making $20 a month in that short of a span is a big deal. Well, they ended up writing about it and covering it, and I got a link from CNN. We got a little thing where they explained it on the news. Like, these are relevant events. I saw the news. I'm like, I'm going to pull something. I quickly put up a blog post. The blog post took me 20 minutes. My dev guy, it took me 20 minutes. And then I reached out to the right people. So taking advantage of current news is great. For example, another one. I'm friends with Startup Grind, Derek Anderson. And he, the other day, when London hit, he immediately reached out to all these founders in London, and he said, or not in Europe, all over, but primarily there. and he's like, hey, I want to know how this is impacting your startup. Are you going to stay? Are you going to do this? And then of the 20 people or 30 people that he reached out to, there was like 12 of the 20 that were planning on moving their startup to a different country in the next month. So he reached out to all these different press organizations. Well, he ended up being covered live on Fox News. He was in New York Times. He was in like three or four other big places solely because he had information and they were like, oh my word, I gotta write a story. Well, how does this relate to small businesses? How many small businesses do you think reacted to that? Instead of us just being like, oh, that sucks, you know, the stock market's down. Like, people who react fast and can really respond fast and go to those people are gonna get press.
Thinking about consumer press, particularly if you've got a product which works with younger children, local TV news on a Saturday morning, they are bored, they need something to cover. Small children do really well on television. Ideally make sure it's near that station so they don't have to send their crew too far. Normally they're in the newsroom. They're in the newsroom for hours on end. It's boring as hell. They want to have something they can get out. They want something that's gonna look good on camera. It's difficult to have software companies look good on camera, but if you can get small children on camera on a Saturday morning, it's entertaining, it's news, it's family style, it will work really well. So that comes down to knowing your sources.
He's not saying to hire children. Just putting that out there clear.
Yeah, or stalk them, no.
Yeah.
And so that comes down to knowing your sources. So industry news. If you're in a specific industry, go for the industry news. They're much more likely to care about the fact that your company's launched because it's industry news. They're much more likely to cover personal elements. They're also much more likely to look for sponsorship at the same time as they're running a story, or can you promote an event that they're running? Can you help them with something that they're doing? But industry news is a great way to get initial take-up for your company. The other thing is, as John was saying at the start, industry news, you might think, well, it's only a small local publication or a small piece of trade press. But do you know what? That's an audience that really cares about the problem you're trying to solve. It's also where a lot of journalists who write for bigger publications also care about that industry, and they will get their news on things that are coming up through that industry news. The other thing is, if you're able to get coverage in those smaller industry publications, as and when you are able to get coverage and take up by a larger publication, when they're doing their background research into who you are as a company, that's valuable sources they can get, and they like to trust those industry sources because that's expert upon expert within an industry that they can really refer to. As you said, people don't really care about the product bit. It's really how do you make it human, relatable, and interesting to those audiences. So think about how you can engage those readers. So when you get an article about your company, look at the comments and engage in those comments. If someone writes a great
article, even if they're negative, engage in them, not in a negative way. But still engage.
Because more people than you think will read the comments. And also the people that read the comments are the people who really care about the topic, who really have that problem, who are most likely to be customers or most likely to be influential in that space. Someone who's an expert on that topic is gonna read the article but also read the comments. Now here's something else about comments. Most people, like I would say only 1 in 1,000 is likely to leave a comment. But those comments are issues that people really, really care about. So if you're not sure, okay, I'm part of this story, what do people really care about in this area? They're really likely to care about the things that people leave comments about. And the comments that really blow up and they have a chain of comments, that issues which people are truly, truly passionate about. And that's often as a writer, that's a great area for me to find topics, but also as a startup, that's a great area for you to find topics to actually pitch and create stories about, and how do you embed your company within those different topics?
So kind of going even a little deeper into comments and stuff like that. So one of my good friends, Dave Kirpin, does anybody know him? Likeable Media, likeable.com. He owns a company and he wrote a book, really good book, spacing on the name, what a great book. But he's been selling it on Amazon for years. And on there, the top comment on there is a negative review. And the negative review is like, what a piece of crap, you know, your book's terrible, I wish you could, you know, I want all my money back and back for my time. You know, my money back for my time. Well, he responded to that. And he's like, hey, I just want to say thank you very much for reading my book. If you want to, send me the copy. Here's my address, and I'll refund you not only for the book, but calculate out how much your time's worth and how much money you put into this, and I'll refund you all the money for your time and the book. Send the book to this address. Well, he said from that, he attributes from emails over 200 sales to that one comment, responding to a hater. Wasn't even a hater. It was just somebody who didn't like what he was doing. There's going to be a lot of haters out there. So don't. There's a big difference, too, between a hater and a troll. I don't respond to trolls. I do respond to haters.
So when you get that article published, make sure you maximize the value you're going to get from that article. Just sending that article to other people in the press, I get lots of emails, hey, I was written about here. Here's the link, write about me too. I didn't care about that.
Delete.
Yeah. However, what you should do, if you have a Facebook fan page for your company, I'd recommend you put that article on the Facebook fan page and you make it a promoted post. Why? Well, we were speaking to a friend of ours who has a Polish company, and he got lots of English press. Now, all of the people on his fan page were Polish, so English is their second language. You might not think you'd get great conversions from that. But him having that third-party review, that third-party endorsement in that those foreign publications, that drove him more traffic from people he saw were fans on his fan page that became customers than he ever did from readers of that that post on its native platform. Because if you're able to say to your customers and near customers, look, other people are writing about us, they think we're part of the solution to this problem, they're likely to become customers. For your existing customers, it's validation that, yes, they bought the right product. They're doing the right thing by using your service. So really maximize that value. Also, have a page on your website of your startup that lists the press that you get. When people are researching to buy your products and services, they want to know who's written about you. The easiest way to do that is to have it right in front of them, have it easily available. Something else, if you have lots of customers, and as you grow, not every single customer is going to be truly happy no matter what you do. And even if it's one of your competitors, someone is going to write some negative things about you. If you have a page on your website with links to all of those reviews are going to rank well in Google Search Engine for your company because they're associated with your company. So they're going to be the top things that come up when people search for your company. Once again, when someone's going to buy something, often they'll then leave your site, whether they go through a link or whether they go straight to Google and they'll research you. What do the reviews say? What has everyone else written about you? Having those nice articles about you makes sense and comes up nicely. So make sure you incorporate all of that. The other thing is, look, getting press is really hard. When you get it, make sure you get the most value out of it. Don't just run on to the next thing, because you're much more likely to get more customers by promoting that existing piece of press than trying to get new press. Make sure you share it out across all your social platforms. Something else is, think of who you're partnering with. Do you partner with other startups? Do you have friends in other startups who are in the same space? Is this news potentially relevant to their customers? Does it help their customers fix potential problems? If you can get them to share it as well, what's that going to do? That's going to increase the amount of attention that you get. So we have 5 minutes left.
Yep.
So let's talk about becoming an influencer, becoming press. Do you want to do that?
Yeah. So you guys, so many more stories I could tell. I'm sorry. But apparently, the grandmaster has told me my direction. You guys, who wants to become press? Yeah? You guys, that's what I did. I found that only so many people will write about my startup. But if I write interesting things, and then that gains people, that gains trust, that'll drive back a lot of people to my community, which if they, you know, realize that I'm an influential person and I'm this, and then I write an amazing story that touches them, they become part of my tribe. And once a person's part of my tribe, they'll purchase anything I put in front of them. So that's why I put out a lot of press, is to, one, help a lot of people, and two, gain customers, in that order, for sure. My goal is not necessarily customers, but it's really, really to help people. And that's what I love doing. And that's why over the years, I've written for a lot of different publications. You guys are like, well, you can't just start. I didn't start like writing for TechCrunch day one. I started and I worked my way up. I started at a little industry publication. And I wrote there. Like, I actually started my own blog. Then I realized I could only get so much distribution on my own blog. So I was like, I'll work my way up. So I went to another publication and I said, hey, I have my own blog, I have a follower, can I write for your site? They said, okay. And then I wrote for them for a while, and then I started working my way up to and from bigger to bigger places until I am where I am today. I'm still trying to work my way up to other places today. And this has been very, very valuable to me. Like, seriously, like, this has driven me more customers. Now I can dictate messages, and in the process, I can help millions and millions and millions of people. I have one post with over 26 million page views, has over 1 million shares. Like, this is like huge for me. Like, I helped that many people. But not only did I help that many people, that post also drives 3 people back to my own site as a customer every single day.
So the thing is with that, you can't just write promotional stuff about your own company. What you've got to once again do, as you've been saying throughout, is you've got to work out who your customers are, what their problems are, and write about the bigger picture. Be part of the bigger picture. Be an expert and a leader in fixing the problems and have the solutions to how you fit in their life, what they're trying to do, and deliver those solutions. And you want to be able to do that in writing as well as through products. If you are not a great writer, find someone who can help you create and write great content. You're all experts in different areas. Can you find someone who can work with you for a few hours, create that great content, and then help you write that great content? Help get that out. And then, can you work with, maybe you know local bloggers, maybe you know trade press, where you could become a contributor? Can you work your way up? Are there other startups? John, I know John writes for a number of different companies, some Adobe, PayPal, et cetera. They're actually all startups in the same space, and obviously some of them are bigger than startups in the same space, payment space. But he's a contributor to those sites about the topics which he wants to be part of the conversation with. And he got those through networking, through going to events. So what I would say to you is, if you are a startup and you're struggling to get press, become part of the storytelling, become part of the media for your own industry, for solving those problems, and become that expert, and that will help you to get more exposure for you and your startup. The other huge benefit of that is that as a writer, you get to understand the process. You get involved in the process. When you're pitching other media, it's a lot easier to pitch other media if you yourself are having to train your brain as to how they're writing, why they're writing, what's important to them. It also helps to be able to network with them if you actually are part of the creative team, if you're else also writing. They'll probably read your writing, they'll know your writing, you'll be writing about similar things. And so it's a great opportunity for you to expand what you're doing conversationally wise, communication wise, and expand your network within the media. So that is 8:07. Do we have anything else? That's it.
That's it, you guys.
So questions?
All right.
Thank you.
No. Thanks, guys. We could share.
Okay, so first question.
So one of my target audience is older population that you may not necessarily find online. What kind of sources would you recommend for teaching?
Repeat the question.
Yeah, so the first question is, her demographic is older people who she says might not be online, and how would you reach those older people? Well, much to my parents' dismay, when they reached 50, certainly in the UK, there's a publication called Saga, which is sent out to everyone over the age of 50 automatically. So there is press that specifically targets older people. So I would say you can always find press that targets older people, and that's very much online as well as other places. Something else, my great uncle loved listening to radio and loved listening to podcasts well into his 90s. So if they're much older, and let's say they can't read, they're likely to be listening to spoken word, and so find where people are creating spoken word, and how do you reach them?
Yeah.
Also, what you can do is if you look at Facebook, you can target people of all demographics, and there are people well into their 90s who are on Facebook, and so you can find press that has great reach within within that demographic. We get coverage by that press and then use Facebook ads to target that press, that media, to people in those older age groups.
I would also say most people over 80 years old do not make the purchasing decisions. It's their children.
Thank you. So. Question at the back.
From a blogging perspective or from your perspective?
Yep.
Okay, so the question is, from a blogging perspective, how would you spend $5,000 to get publicity, John?
That's a loaded question. First of all, what's your goal behind it?
Views.
His goal is views.
Views, views what?
Download my app.
Download my app. The best money, one person paid me $5,000 and I ended up getting them on TechCrunch, which then got... went on to Fox News and like 40 other people. They paid me and I pitched it to another writer. I didn't write about it personally. That would have been awesome. Haha, give it to me. But if I was personally using it, I would write as much content as I can, amazing content. And then I would put a little bit of it into influencer marketing.
Yeah, I know it's a hard question.
Yeah.
You really have to kind of know the business and what the app is.
Yeah. That's a very loaded question. Yeah.
So the how to spend that $5,000. Well, we've discussed, we have various different ventures and we have various different ways of doing that. We've actually, for different projects that we've worked on, we've actually bought blogs within the niche. So we've owned some niche publications as a way to kickstart us being owners within that. Last week, I do a lot of work with YouTube celebrities. And I was just hired by an app company to hire a bunch of YouTube celebrities to create videos about the app. They create content that gets, each video will get millions of views. So for purely app downloads, they weren't caring about other types of thing. Hiring people that create viral content and paying them to create viral content for an app download in targeting youth with a comical thing, it was exactly right for that audience. We hired them to do that project. So there are different ways of creating a conversation and reaching different audiences. Thanks. So,
okay, and then we got Dale. Oh, that's a loaded question.
Yeah.
Okay.
So basically, we want kids to like it, but we also want parents to buy it because
So this is a, just to try and summarize that question, this is a question about launching an app for kids food app to help kids make choices in buying food. How do they reach the kids and how do they reach the adults at the same time?
Yeah, so again, loaded, but I would personally, I'd get it into different elementary schools, work with the different districts. I'd also work with large organizations. For example, there's a very, very large organization called
BizWorld
up in San Francisco that you should definitely be a part of. They have 140,000 kids under the age of 14 that are all part of their organization, startup people just like yourself, all over the thing. I'd get in contact with people like that because they can push it out to all their people and all the kids and then make the kids go up to the parents. I find that really anything my daughter wants, she kind of gets. Similar probably with a lot of parents. I don't feel it comes down. I feel it goes up. BizWorld.org.
Yeah. Thanks.
Dale.
Yeah. For you personally, yep. 200 pitches a day, what is your filter for picking the one out of 200?
So the question Dale is, how for the camera, how do you pick through the filter of 200 pitches a day?
First of all, I have instructions on pitching me, so if they don't follow my instructions, I delete them. So first is self-indulgence, tell me how amazing I am. Most people will be like, ha, 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 you're cool. And I know they've gone through my filter, and they actually know the form I want them to pitch me in. The other time, the rest of them, it's if I think it's cool or not, or if I'm passionate about it. I write for many different audiences, but yeah, I definitely match it to that audience.
And then you're trying to pick the one that gets you the most views.
Yeah, or cool stories. Like I had a 90-year-old man that was starting a startup, and he was like, I'm 90, and I'm starting this, and it's starting to gain some traction. I was like, it's a cool story. Like it's different. It's unusual. Something people haven't heard of. Just wrote about one the other day where a guy started a company and they did $240 million in revenue last year in their second year of business. And it's like, nobody's ever written about him. So I met another kid that pitched me the other day that in his second year of business, he sells cell phones and he did almost $900 million. His second year of business, and he's still not finished. He's projecting like $1.1 billion. No company's ever written about him. And he is 21 years old, you guys.
So what are you doing with your time?
Yeah, exactly. But I mean, those are unusual, but like, I do things that are cool to me, and those things are cool to me, and lots of other people find cool. So if you can relate it to my audience and what I find cool, you might get written about.
Thank you. Next question.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to violate the first principle by asking you where you're going to be at your second place so I can show
where
you.
I'm going to be. I'm going to be in Poland speaking at an event.
So the question was if you want to meet John regularly, where do you meet John?
I typically attend different startup events. I really like larger startup events, typically with hundreds of people. I attend almost every single financial conference in the area or any major publication conference in the area.
So if you look at John's LinkedIn, you see, if you didn't know him, you'd see that he, although as well as being a writer, he has a startup called Due, which is an online invoicing company. Therefore, he's interested in anything in the financial technology, fintech space. Therefore, he's likely to go to fintech events in the Bay Area. And so that's probably the best way to hunt him down.
Okay, we had one right there.
So I would like you guys to elaborate a little bit on how you're saying, you know, find the right writer that's interested in the right space. But can you tell us a little bit more about your process from your end? So let's say I have the best idea in the world, I pitch it to you. You write for 20 different how does that process work in your end? Because not every place necessarily wants to publish what you're having to write, correct?
Yeah, so if I repeat the question, it's you write for a lot of places, so how do I pitch you,
yes.
Essentially? I'm very, very unique, as in I write for tons of publications. Most people like me, you pitch them a cool thing, or you become friends with them. The majority of publications now are moving to a contributor model. Like, for example, Entrepreneur Magazine laid off all but three reporters. So they only have three on their entire staff, versus they now have 260 contributors.
So.
Correct. Submit it to them, and they say yes or no.
So that's actually an interesting point. There was a survey, there's some data came out recently, that there are now 4.8 PR people for every journalist. So if you think getting written about is not easy, and you're not a professional doing this, there are 4.8 professionals trying to pitch those poor journalists every day. One of the things that's sort of inaccurate about that, but one of the things that John was alluding to, is that although there are less paid journalists, because that comes from the labor statistics, there are more and more publications that have contributors. So Huffington Post has like 10,000 contributors on different topics. So that comes back down to, okay, find out who has written about similar related topics. Find out who they are. Find out ideally the people locally or the events you're going to, where they're going to go, and try and track them down. And find out what works for those types of publication. Something that you can do with the publications is lots of them have a trending or popular articles section. And so that will tell you what's popular with those audiences. So you know, okay, this writer writes for these publications, and these are the things that are popular with that audience. Can you find a way to make your startup fit within one of those popular topics? And how would you position that, and how would you communicate that?
Yeah, so kind of, I didn't really answer your question. If you're pitching someone like me, because there's a lot of us out there that write for many publications, stock a specific publication, and don't pitch me general. Pitch me for a specific.
This would work really well for your column here. This is why your audience is going to love it.
So, next question right there. You mean in the back, by the way? You got to raise your hand. I can't see you. But great. Yeah, all in all, I spent $286,000, a couple bucks. I know that because when the company paid me, I made them pay me that in addition.
Just me
going around and promoting it. Really, it was only probably about $40,000, $50,000 in travel, and the rest was promotion. I promote the shit out of things. So we didn't really go into that. That's a whole nother conversation on how much money we put towards things. But I, you know, instead of pitching 10 different press people, pitch one and nail it. And like put $10,000 towards it in ads and have it blow up. Like that's what TechCrunch is really good at, getting the word out there. But if you can make a post like pop on TechCrunch and like get, I mean, my average post on there probably gets like 6,000 to 8,000 shares, but it'll be trending on their most popular page for like 2 to 3 days. And I'll make sure it stays there. I'll get all my friends, ex-girlfriends, ex-friends, I'll email everybody to comment and like it and share it. And then I'll spend tens of thousands of dollars promoting one post because I want it to be there, because if it's there, other people are gonna see it, and everybody wants to be cool. So this is cool, so let's write about it, because if it's doing well here, it'll do well on us as well.
So was that a planned budget, or was it like...
No, that was, I maxed out every credit card possible.
So you didn't expect that?
No. Well, I mean, I expected I would spend a whole lot of money. My wife would say I kind of jump off a cliff and figure out a way how to tweet my way to the bottom. So
we had
back in the back.
Yep.
Yeah,
so the question is, how cool is Dew? And if everyone could ask John how cool his startups are, he'd be able to pitch them all live.
Yeah, everybody better go sign up. Yeah, no, I'm just joking. Yes. But Dew is an invoicing and payments platform. Totally the most non-sexy thing in the world, payments. Who likes payments? No, they're boring as shit. They're seriously the most boring thing. But we pull data and we put together interesting things like that Grace thing. We pulled a lot of data and we said this is happening and now it's not. And we also pulled like what people do to get paid. Like, did you guys know you're less likely to be paid by someone that is under 48 miles from your house? Like, if a person lives within 48 miles of your house, you're 4 times less likely to be paid than a person further. And if it's greater than 2,000 miles, you have a 90% chance of being paid. We put together things like that make it a little more sexy, that we can have fun with. I mean, not using a completely different thing, but there are very different, very hard niches to put out there. And I laugh at one. One is in the pornographic space, which we're all like, oh my word, don't talk about that, blah, 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 blah. But one of these places puts together which state. Is it a boob or a butt state? And they put data on that. It's a totally, like, not thing that we talk about. Like, no writer ever wants to link to a porn site. Like, ever. Or a payment site. Like, it's not cool. But, like, if you can make it cool and put together interesting data that people care about, that's what makes it cool, and that's what people really want to talk about. So that's how I make it sexy, is I do those different things. I talk at different events like this, and I do a bunch of stuff like that to promote it.
But let me make that sexier for John, okay? Who likes doing invoicing? No one. Who likes money? Everyone. In order to get money, you need to send invoices. Position it right. Make it exciting. Catch the interest. Okay, you like money. We can help you get money faster, better, cheaper. We can make sure you get paid on time. That's a way to sell invoicing in a much more exciting, sexy way. Everyone has problems with that. You can talk about how do you get paid faster. You can talk about which types of industry need payment more than the other. Did you know, for example, that now currently about 20% of the US population are freelancers? Within a few years, that's going to be 50% of the population are going to be freelancers.
By 2020, do you guys know that? They estimate that 50% of the working population in the United States will be a freelancer.
So why is payments exciting? Payments exciting because all of a sudden 30% of the working population of America are going to need to send invoices. So that's why it's a growing market and that's why he's interested in it. Just to give you like a reason for it to be more exciting.
Back here.
Okay, so the question is, how do you package content to be interesting and how do you make it compelling?
So myself, I just like things that are really interesting to me. I'll pass it typically, like Marie and I will have little powwow sessions where we'll come up with titles and information. And if it's interesting to both of us and like 2 or 3 other people, most likely it's interesting to everybody.
So let me elaborate on that. Okay, so think about this. As a writer, you're thinking about writing your next article. One of the things you'll spend most time on is the title, because that can dramatically change the impact your article is going to have.
Yeah, you guys, I spend 50 to 70% of my time writing an article on just the title.
So when you're going to send a pitch email, have a great title. Have a great story that you're pitching them. Know exactly the type of title that's going to work for those publications and pitch them the title. And then pitch them 3 or 4 lines that's the gist of the story. If you're able to get them to spend enough time to read that, it says several things. It says, it's not an email that says, I'm launching my startup, please find the attached press release and get back to me if you like it. No, send them the title, send them the bits, you're much more likely to get their attention, and then go on with the rest of the story. Never email them and saying, hey, I've got a great startup. Can I send you a press release? Why would I want to respond to that? So just think about, the title and that first paragraph. If you've got my attention, then I'll read on from there. but I'm not interested in like some other kind of, and don't send me a story that's just like 20 pages of text. How does that help me? I'm trying to do my startup and write for publications. I've got my time to set aside for doing that. I'm trying to do my job as fast as possible. Help me do my job. Okay, is that
questions? Any other ones?
We'll be around for a little bit. It's probably 8.
Yeah, it's 8:30.
It's 8:30. And we've been told that we've got a little, one more.
Repeat the question.
So the question is, what are the main errors?
What are the main errors people seeing? I see people all the time. I mean, just horrible pitches, man. I could send you like 50.
The main thing is they get an email list from who knows where, from their friend who's created an email list of press people, and they just attach a press release and they send it out to everyone. I say it's pure spam. It's from someone
when
I don't know.
They spell my name wrong.
Yeah,
it's a bad one.
But they said they send it out to everyone. Now, press release has just gone out to everyone. I want to create original, great content for my readers. If I think 50 other people have written about it, probably I'm not going to be interested in it. Also, I just don't care about random spam that comes in. Because do you know why I get so much other random spam that's not even press related? It just goes in my random spam. So that's really the thing. Number one thing is have a great story that really solves someone's problem, know how to package it, and then know exactly who to send it to as an original thing that you have a relationship with someone with.
All right, you guys, that's it.
Thank you very much.